Hi there, I'm Ava with Drexel TV's Inside Ambition. We are on Instagram at @inside_ambition, and as always, check out our YouTube and our Twitter pages. Today, I'm talking with Brooklyn Leon, a Drexel senior, a varsity cheerleader, and an advocate for sexual assault awareness on campus. Brooklyn recently came forward on her Instagram and shared her story of reporting her sexual assault at Drexel. And it's a story that's pretty hard to hear. So Brooklyn, first of all, thanks for being here and for bringing recognition to the issue of sexual assault at Drexel. It's definitely one that impacts every single student at the school.
So, thank you for having me.
Yeah, of course. Thank you for coming on. So I wanted to start by asking you, and please only share what you're comfortable with, if you could walk us through your story of reporting your assault. I know you talked about seeing the person who assaulted you at a Drexel basketball game, how difficult that was for you, and even the fact that they were allowed there in the first place. So if you don't mind sharing, how did the school or the police handle your case, and how do you feel about how things kind of ended up with that?
Yes, so originally my assault happened in the summer of 2021. Originally, I did not come forward. I didn't report anything. I didn't think that I had enough evidence for it to go anywhere. So, you know, I just kind of warned my friends and the people close to me about the situation. Later in the year, I came back to school and I started cheer again. We started at our basketball games, and the very first game, he was there. I was not expecting to see him there. He is a graduated student. He has been graduated for about 2 or 3 years now. So I really was not anticipating seeing him again. So that was just a really like shocking moment for me, and it was hard. So after that, I went through and I reported Drexel, because at that point I felt like even if I didn't have enough evidence, I thought at least I could report it and maybe other women would have similar stories. So I went through with Drexel, I reported through Drexel. We started a case. They had made it so he wasn't at games anymore. So I kind of thought things were resolved. I hadn't really heard back from people at Drexel. And so I just thought, you know, okay, they resolved the issue. He would not be there anymore. And then at my homecoming game, he was there again. This game was particularly like startling for me because the whole gym was packed with people because it was our homecoming game, obviously. And he stood directly behind the cheer team the entire game alone, which I thought was kind of triggering. I felt like he was trying to intimidate me by standing there. There was no reason that I could come up with other than to try and intimidate me for him to be standing there. At that point, I went and spoke to the person who oversees the spirit teams. Mm-hmm. And he had told me there was nothing that could be done about him being there. So I spent the rest of my senior year homecoming game just really uncomfortable the entire time. I felt like very intimidated and threatened by him being there. And it was just an uncomfortable feeling. So after that, I was really upset, obviously. So after about a week, I took some time to think, and I decided to post the post that students have seen at this point now, because I've heard from multiple women that they have not received adequate care afterwards, after reporting. So I wanted to come forward and say that. After that, I reached out to a professor at Drexel. She met with me and she was so incredibly nice and helpful. She sent me resources at Drexel Police for people to meet with there. There is someone who works specifically with sexual assault victims. You can just talk to, you don't have to officially do any reports or anything if you're not comfortable doing that, for other people who were interested. She helps you go over everything the police are going to ask you. So it's not as intimidating when you go to report to the police if you decide that's what you want to do. The professor I talked to also wanted to, with a couple organizations on campus, set up some sort of march possibly, or a letter that we could do. I know a lot of girls had reached out to me after my post and wanted to do more. The office that deals with sexual assault on Drexel's campus is severely understaffed, from my understanding. which I think is an incredible disservice. I mean, for any school, you should have an like ample amount of staff for something so sensitive and so urgent to our safety, our physical, emotional safety, but especially at Drexel where we're paying so much, you know, if we're putting this much money into our education, we should be getting more out of it than just an education.
Yes, I completely agree. And I'm so sorry that you had to go through that. And so since you're talking about the Office of Equality and Diversity, I know you talked about in your post as well. You talked about how they're overwhelmed with cases a lot of the times. So do you think that a lot of other victims of these crimes at Drexel are having a similar experience as you and just not having their needs met with what they're asking for?
Yeah, I can say definitely people are not having their needs met. Many women reached out to me afterwards saying that they had went through the same issues where I heard some people, it took them almost 2 years for their case to be fully completed.
Wow.
So for people like me, I'm graduating, I'm leaving. Mm-hmm. You know, it kind of feels like my case is maybe going to be pushed aside because I'm leaving. They're going to take priority over the kids that are still going to be here. But for those kids that are still going to be here, it's still like they are waiting 2 years into their education and their college experience to feel safe. And it's that's not appropriate, but.
Yeah, of course.
And I know talking with staff there, they had briefly expressed that they had multiple like cases going on. So I know that they have plenty of cases to deal with.
Wow.
Staff there, I want to say, they were really supportive and really nice, and they were willing to listen and everything. So I don't think that it is like a caring on their part. I think it is a lack of resources.
I see. So in that case, how do you think these cases should be handled going forward? Do you think that we should invest more into the office? Do you think that we should focus on hiring more staff? Better education about sexual assault? What are some ways that you think we should go about it?
I think definitely we should hire more staff. A lot that goes into this is obviously having legal teams, because there is like legality issues behind all of this. You know, you can't just take everyone for their word. You have to like, you know, investigate, and it's a whole investigation. So having more staff so they have time to kind of focus on smaller amounts of cases at a time, so that they can be more, I guess, invested in the cases that they're working on, as well as hiring more people for their legal team so that they know that legally everything they're doing and they're following every step. Because if you were to mess up legally, that could get the whole case, you know, thrown away or not taken care of completely, so.
Definitely. And do you think it would be worthwhile for Drexel to even invest in educating students on sexual assaults and rape and, you know, what happens, what the consequences of that are, and what kind of boundaries people would want to set for themselves?
Yeah, so I think definitely number one, talking about what consent is and, you know, when you've gone too far. You know, maybe you have well intentions, but you are pushing it too far, and that is sexual assault. You know, if you're doing something that someone doesn't want you to do, whether you think it's mixed signals or not, communication is the best way to, you know, make sure everyone in the situation is safe and comfortable with what's happening. Number two, I think more education on the process of filing for reports. You know, I didn't initially report because I didn't think I had evidence, quote unquote, and, you know, I don't have video evidence. I don't have that, you know, but there's other things that they look at for evidence, which I had learned about until I did report. They look at interviewing friends that you saw afterwards, family that you saw afterwards, and investigating how your mood or your behavior had changed afterwards, to kind of take that in account as evidence. And that's what they actually use in court as well. So you don't need to have physical evidence always. And I think people don't understand. I honestly did not know that until after speaking with them.
Honestly, I didn't know about half of the things you just said. I didn't know about looking at people's moods as a piece of evidence, but that's definitely something that more people could learn about and is definitely overlooked, the legal side of it. Totally agree. So what do you think are some ways that students can get involved and help with informing Drexel about the seriousness of this issue? I know you just talked about the Sexual Assault Awareness March that you're helping to organize. So can you share more with us about it?
Yeah, so we haven't honestly organized much at all yet. So there'll definitely be more coming out with that. And I will update you. I can send you an email when that comes out.
Absolutely.
April is Sexual Assault Awareness Month. So that would be an awesome time to have that sort of march. And then reaching out to the board at Drexel as well with a letter, maybe addressing them and, you know, pleading with them. We need more resources for our students here and for our safety.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you see yourself maybe organizing a letter writing type of campaign sometime in the future?
Yeah, so I will most likely work with the same professor that I spoke to in person after all the events after homecoming, and then going over the best way to word it. And, you know, obviously this is a sensitive topic and it's very easy to show your emotions through when you're writing. And I don't want it to be too angry. I want something to truly be done. So I don't want it to push people too far or maybe make them too uncomfortable. I don't know if that's the right way to word it, but I definitely do want to write it with a professor and someone who has kind of worked in this field before so that we can make sure we get the best results possible for everyone.
Yeah, I think that's really well said, and that seems like a really great way to go about it. So one thing I'm wondering is students who have been in your position and are going through the same things that you went through, what advice would you give them?
Yeah, so I would say, number one, there are people that you can talk to. Maybe you don't feel that way. Whether it be family, friends, therapist, you could go to school counseling. There's also a lot of places that will do online counseling now through Zoom. I would say also, if you are comfortable reporting, you know, I would encourage women to report so that Drexel is kind of made more aware of what's happening on campus, as well as we are holding people accountable for their actions and making the community know, making them well aware that, you know, sexual harassment is not okay and there will be consequences for it. It is really hard to come forward. I know a lot of girls don't want to, and it's really uncomfortable. And that's a personal choice, absolutely. So I would say talk to someone. Mostly counselors, I would say. Obviously, talk to friends and family. Counselors are going to have great support and great answers. Also, my professor, she was an awesome person to talk to. There are so many professors that are really awesome, and they will talk to you and they will help you through things. They will set you up with the right people that you need to meet with to get you the resources you need. So, talking to people and reporting if you're comfortable.
Thank you for that. That is such incredible advice, and I hope that's really useful to people who are listening.
Finally, let's imagine and let's hope that all of Drexel's administration is listening to you right now. What would you say to them?
I think on a really emotional level, I would say, think as if these students are your children. If they're your sons and daughters, would you want them going through the same situations? And if they unfortunately had to go through that, how would you want people to respond? You know, we have the money at school, you know, I mean, our tuition is so expensive. We have the money, we have the funds to do it. It's not a lack of funds, you know. And I would like to give them the benefit of the doubt and think that maybe they're not aware of how severe the issue is on campus. But if they are aware, I think it is like negligent to not take care of the office dealing with all of these sexual assault victims. You know, they need more resources. We need more resources. And everyone on campus needs to be made aware that there will be consequences for this behavior.
Thank you, Brooklyn. That is so well said. And I hope that our students and our administration will take heed. from what you have to share. We will include details about the upcoming Sexual Assault Awareness March in the description, as well as Brooklyn's Instagram, so that all of you watching can get involved. Be sure to check out Inside Ambition on our Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter to see more interviews like this. And tune in next time. Thank you guys, bye.